presentation will be focusing on these three questions. The first one is, well, what is statistics? Number two, what statistical analyses are used in action research? And number three, is there a need to use inferential statistics in action research? And I do hope that by answering these three questions, our action researchers will be more prepared to face the tasks ahead in terms of quantitative data analysis and presentation. So basically, if we have to refer to statistics, this is the study of how to collect, organize, analyze, and interpret numerical information from data. And for many of you, you might be interested to collect numerical data in order to make sure that indeed you have addressed the issues and problems that you have in your classroom. So as teachers, for sure, you have processed numerical data already, such as grades of students, scores of students. You collect these data through tests, through surveys, and any other means. You also organize by creating charts or tables or organizing these data on your class record. Analysis is also part of your job as teacher, of our job as teachers. So we use Excel, we use SPSS, or a manual computation in order to analyze the data that we have, and interpretation, such as determining if a student has passed a particular subject or not, is also part of our job. So definitely, we gotta do away with statistics when we teach. We classify statistics as descriptive or inferential. And when we speak of descriptive statistics, this will enable us to summarize and organize characteristics of a data set, which is a collection of responses or observations from a sample or entire population. So you may just consider one class or one school, so it doesn't really matter. But for inferential statistics, we use hypothesis testing, and we may consider parametric or non-parametric statistics. Inferential statistics can help us decide whether the data that we have collected can be generalized to a larger population. We can use this to test if indeed that data that we have collected from the sample can also be true for a broader group, no? Which we refer to as population. And that population must be defined by the researcher. For descriptive statistics, you might have encountered already these statistical tools, such as measures of central tendency, mean, median, and mode, measures of location, percentile, decile, quartile, and measures of dispersion, such as variance, standard deviation, and range. For inferential statistics, we have regression tests, correlation tests, such as Spearman-Rowe and Pearson's R, comparison tests such as t-test, ANOVA, Crystal-Wallis, Manwiti-U test, and Wilcoxon and Sine-Rank test, and many more. So now that we have a background about statistics, let's now go to the second question. What statistical analyses are used in action research? Oftentimes, descriptive statistical analyses are used. As stated by Kogan and Broden-Miller in 2014, exploratory data analysis is oftentimes used in action research. Its techniques are designed to probe for possible patterns among the individual responses in the sample, rather than using the data to statistically generalize to a larger population. And from this statement, we can somehow conclude that we are not really required to have the inferential statistics part in our action research. Okay. So let's just have some examples for us to know what statistical tools are used by action researchers based on published articles. So in this example, the title of the action research is An Action Research to Overcome Undergraduates' Laboratory Anxiety. I just would like to emphasize the word overcome in the title. No? So that word will tell us that indeed the researchers would like to achieve a solution. This is not just simply to test if a particular intervention is effective or not. The researchers would really like to arrive at the solution, and that is to overcome. So frequency is used. Percentage is also used. So these are statistical tools and descriptive in nature. So when you speak of frequency, that's very easy. You just have to count. Everybody knows that. For percentage, of course, the formula is just very simple. That is just part divided by whole times 100%. And as shown here in the sample, we have 53% to 10%. No, that is just a decrease. So there is no explanation whether such decrease is statistically significant or not. And the researcher also included a table, and in the table, the frequency is shown, the percentage is also shown. Let's now have another example. This one also came from the same journal, and the title is Collaborative Action Research to Promote Reflective Thinking Among Higher Education Students. Again, I just would like to emphasize the word promote. Now, and basing from the title, we can really see that the researcher would like to arrive at a solution, and that is the promotion of something, specifically reflective thinking. In the results, the researchers decided to include the mean scores. Yeah. So figure 2 shows midterm and final mean scores based on assessments of student reflective thinking for the 9 courses. So when we speak of the mean, that is the computational average. We have different kinds of averages. Mean is the computational average, and it's symbolized by X bar. But sometimes when we present our result, we use the capital letter M. We just have to italicize that. So this is the formula. This is just simply the summation of X sub 1 plus X sub 2 plus ellipsis plus X sub N all over N. So it simply states that all you have to do is to add the scores and divide by the number of scores added. This is the graphical presentation of the results. In example number 2, bar graphs are used. And for each course, midterm assessment and final assessment are compared. So you can really see how the mean scores have increased, no? In terms of level of reflective thinking. So now let's proceed to the third question, which I think I have already answered a while ago. Is there a need to use inferential statistics in action research? Well, the quick answer is no. As stated by Dewsbury and Twimanoff in 2021, unlike traditional experimental research, with action research, you make change and observe the impact on your entire group of interest. You will not need to generalize from your sample to a broader population. Instead, you generalize from your sample to a similar sample. From this Encyclopedia of Action Research, we can also see that action research has been recognized as a qualitative research. That is why in this example, entitled Action Research for Improving the Risk Literacy of University Students, Focusing on the Effectiveness of Risk Communication Using Crossroad Game, we can see that no quantitative analysis is used. So again, I just would like to emphasize the word improving, and let's take a glimpse at how the results are being presented. So the researcher simply included here extracts from transcript. I realize that there are several judgments and ways of thinking with regard to one thing. So no numbers. You don't need to compute for the mean, no frequency, no percentage. So the actual researcher here decided to use qualitative data to justify that indeed, no, the risk literacy has improved. Now let's have another example. It's entitled Action Research on the Impact of Student Grouping. For the findings, narratives are also used. Now, we also have to reflect on this. While most action research involves qualitative methods, there are situations where the data calls for a quantitative approach. And that's okay. You know, if you are comfortable also with using inferential statistics and you believe that that is also vital for your reflection, then go, now use inferential statistics. We have here another example. I got this from the Journal of Teacher Action Research. We have the title, Teaching Preservice Teachers About Microaggression, Knowing It's Just a Pencil. So we have this part wherein standard deviation is reported together with the mean. Now, mean and standard deviation always go together. And t-test is used. So t-test is shown here. And the author stated that the t-test revealed a significant difference. So if that will make you comfortable, that will make you happy as an action researcher, go use inferential statistics. Let's have another example. The title is Teaching Vocabulary to At-Risk Third Grade Students, Paper and Pencil Activities versus Technology Activities. In the results, a t-test showed that this difference was very significant at p is equal to zero. So those are two examples that would show the use of inferential statistics in action research. Let's take time to reflect on this statement. PAR, one type of action research, which is participatory action research, combines research and action through a cyclic or spiral process, which alternates between action and critical reflection. It lays emphasis on authenticity rather than on the scientific validity of the information. Therefore, statistically significant and generalizable conclusions are generally avoided. So we have answered, I have answered those three questions. Feel free to ask more questions in the chat box if you have. And I do hope that by answering those three questions, you have now a glimpse on how to analyze and present quantitative data and action research. Just remember that whatever statistical tool that you are going to choose, it must be aligned with your objectives and research design. And as shown by Dr. Bilbao a while ago, action research is a process that involves observing, reflecting, planning, and acting on everyday problems or issues about teaching and learning. We need to be directed with this, and we have to make sure that we have addressed the problems and issues that we have in teaching and learning.